invite Jeffrey Rediger. Dr. Rediger's talk is entitled A Medicine of Hope and Possibility. Jeffrey Rediger is on the faculty of Harvard Medical School. He's the medical director of McLean and Community Affairs at McLean Hospital. He's a licensed physician and board certified psychiatrist. He also has a theological seminary. His research with remarkable individuals who have recovered from illness considered incurable has been featured on the Oprah Winfrey and Dr. Oz shows, among others. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jeffrey Rediger.
It's a real honor to be here this weekend. I must say, my first experience yesterday, you can actually talk about these things openly. I come from an academic world where you're trained very well how to conform. So it's really Brazil that got me going down this research pathway a long time ago, and very grateful for the way it messed up my life and thinking completely. You have people like Andrea who sent me books, the Spirit's book, and others that provided a real source of education. And what you find is that my experience, and I'd been to seminary and been to medical school and had a lot of training. Is that better? Had a lot of training, but I'd worked really hard in theology and philosophy of science while in seminary and then in medical school, really interested in the deep assumptions that lie underneath all of these disciplines and help us answer the questions that the disciplines were founded upon. But what's fascinating is in the world as I understood it and interpreted it, and I read lots and lots of theologians and philosophers and scientists, is that the body is thought to be the primary datum. And Brazil kind of turned that all upside down for me. Made me even more confused for a while, but ended up giving me a world that actually made sense and that everything fell together and cohered in a way that heals the soul, I believe. So there's a lot I'm grateful for around all of that, and has been so eloquently said in these other talks and conversations I've had. The body is more, I believe, a reflection of a deeper story that is being worked out in the life of the person. And once you begin to see that that is the case, it makes sense. And there's so many other things that become possible. So we're going to try to talk about that today. Since that upside down experience that Brazil helped bring about for me, I've been doing some research. As when in conversation this morning with Dr. Marita Almeida Moreira, and I think you made a comment, something to the effect about Brazil carrying the heart of the world in some ways spiritually. And I think there's something to that. You know, everyone is placed in this world for a reason, and every group is placed in this world for a reason. I wonder if that is what's held in the world, is that space of the heart, and that's what the world is groaning towards in terms of beginning to recover that. So that certainly has been the role it's played in my life, for sure. So let's get started. I want to talk about a medicine of hope and possibility and how we can use these stories to begin driving change in healthcare and help participate in what wants to happen, which is the democratization of medicine, where we give people back their lives and their bodies, and doctors become consultants instead of the experts over your life and body, even though they only spend 15 minutes with you. So, I've been doing this research since 2003. It was a nurse at Mass General Hospital in Boston who asked me if I would sit down with her son and explain to him that she had been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, which is a devastating diagnosis. It's usually death, and there's not thought to be really much cure for most forms of pancreatic cancer. She went to Brazil to see John of God and began calling me and writing me saying, you got to come down here and see what's going on. there's something happening, and there's evidence for it. I said, no, thank you. I had just graduated from residency, just had this new faculty position, medical director, and was concerned about what my peers would think. So she said, okay, well, I'll just have people start calling you and writing you and telling me that their stories existed and that they had medical evidence. Did I want to see the data? So the truth, the long and short of it is I did go to Brazil in 2003, and since then have been collecting medical evidence for accurate diagnosis for illnesses that are traditionally considered incurable, and then the evidence that the illness is either gone or sharply reduced in severity, and then trying to understand what are the factors that are associated with that. So I've been doing that not only in Brazil, which is where I started, but also other places around the world and in the United States. And what you start to see after a while is that Western culture is brilliant at looking at the small, breaking things down into its constituent parts, looking at the parts and how they are. We have these universities, which are really not universities, they're multiversities. They say at Harvard the only thing that connects all the different departments is that it's got a common heating plant. And it's really true. What's great is that's slowly changing because now interdisciplinary work is now becoming more accepted. There used to be a lot of resistance to standing on the borders of disciplines and looking at things in different ways, and now we're starting to realize that brings enormous amount of fruitfulness and promising inventions and discoveries, and that's a really great thing to begin doing more of. So that's slowly beginning to change. So, but what you start to see is when you stand back and look at the big picture, instead of with their blinders on, these disciplinary ghettos, what you see in the big picture is that there are transdiagnostic factors of health and illness and vitality that are a really big deal. Instead, what we do in medicine is we look for pathways in individual diseases, but we don't stand back and look at the big picture and realize that there are aspects and factors of health and vitality that are really important, and we just don't even study them. We have a science of disease and not a science of health. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. One of the things that I've learned along the way is that there's nothing spontaneous about spontaneous remission. These people have made huge changes in their life at every level, and it's not the doctors or the medicines that are getting them better. And it's just that we've never asked what's been going on. And so common sense suggests that just like we study ultimate performers in business and in sports, we should be studying the ultimate performers in health. Unfortunately, the process of becoming a physician is a very powerful socialization process, and conformity is a big deal. And if you step outside of those lines, the consequences are swift, and they can be really severe, whether it's medical, legal, or what your peers think of you. And there's a real, it's stepping outside of that dominant materialist paradigm, which is talked about a lot here this weekend. So the idea of studying these ultimate performers in health, I can't tell you how many times patients will have these improbable recoveries and they will say, well, I told my doctor and they weren't interested, or I told my doctor and they got angry and didn't want to talk about it anymore. They thought I was a non-compliant patient. And this things happen over and over and over again. And doctors don't publish these cases of spontaneous remission. So doctors are taught these things never happen. They actually happen a lot more frequently than we realize. They're just buried out there in the culture, and they're unacknowledged, and they don't have a voice or a place. So it's a wilderness we need to chart. So the polarity between religion and science. It's a history of choosing sides. What's fascinating to me is I think a lot of our assumptions have been guided by 18th century biology and physics, and that has shaped the worldview in many ways. And we could have a long discussion about all of this. Religion and science have been at war for a long time, but spirituality and modern science are very compatible and deeply synergistic even. And so the world is shifting at a deep level, but we in our institutions and in our academic disciplines, we haven't really caught up to where I think people living their lives really are. And so that's a big topic in itself. But so if you're on the science side, of these intermission. You say it's a fluke, it has no sign. On the spiritual side or the religious side, you call these miracles or you call them spiritual healing. What's true is all of these terms are black boxes, and we've never used science to unpack what's really going on here. We've never really investigated the factors associated with these things. And I'm telling you, whether an illness takes 10 minutes or 10 years, I believe that in a person's soul or consciousness that's going on here. And so these are identifiable factors that I believe. So today, we're going to talk a little bit about the power of stories to provide ethical, grounded hope. Doctors are often reticent to examine things like this because they don't want to give patients false hope. And there's all kinds of things that are set up to protect people to protect doctors from giving false hope. I think that's wise and that's smart, but I think it's also really important in a moral imperative that we also know how to give patients grounded ethical hope that's rooted in genuine medical evidence. People need realistic beliefs, but we also need, there are some people that they're given a diagnosis and I can't tell you how many times somebody will be given a life-ending diagnosis and it will become the pathway of liberation for them because they'll say, you know what, I've been taking care of everyone else for my entire life. I've been doing what I should do. I've been trying to meet the expectations of others. And I think that the illness is often caught up in that in some way, and people have been living someone else's life. They're living a life that they think they should live, or the life that they thought was they're supposed to live, or they're trying to just meet the expectations of everyone else. And the liberation that can come from a diagnosis that says you're going to die, all of a sudden a person can sometimes have the freedom to actually say, now I can finally do something for myself. There's a diagnosis that says I need to do something different with my life, and that becomes an opportunity. So these things are fascinating stories and insights into illness. It was really Brazil that taught me that our illnesses can come and go based upon whether you're in a toxic relationship at the time or in a toxic work environment, and you would see an illness disappear, and then when they go back into that experience, which they regarded as toxic, the illness would return and start to really begin. These things live not just in the physical body, but in a higher place within us, and these things can be addressed. So I think what's really exciting is that the disease model is slowly being supplanted by approaches that are built on what's right about us. I think for thousands of years, we've had ways of thinking that haven't done full justice to the magnificence and goodness of what we each bring into the world. And so we've had models of the human being that have been really rooted in what's wrong or missing in us. And that's true not only in medicine, but in other disciplines. In medicine, it's been about the disease model, and we'll talk a little bit about that. That was a great step forward when we first did that, created the disease model, but it's still a model of disease. It's not rooted in what's right about us. I think Western theology made a really critical mistake when it began emphasizing the original sin in all of us instead of the fact that more fundamentally we're all created in the image of God. That's a theology that is built on what's right with us. I think that Ellen Kardec and Xavier have a theology that's very healthy-minded and rooted in what's right with us. I spent years reading theology in seminary and after that, and I'm telling you, it's a refreshing theology to experience something that's rooted in what's right about you, and it opens up a level of possibilities that is not possible in a theology rooted fundamentally in original sin, in my belief. So psychology has been rooted, you know, has only been around really for 100 years or a little bit more. It's really been too much occupied with deficits of childhood. That's also a deficit-based model. Psychiatry has long been preoccupied with neurochemical defects. So to see models of health moving in the direction of what's right about all of us. So we all know what the old models are doing to us. It's the only treatment option he has under his current health plan. So You know, I could be the best cure for insomnia for you today. I could tell you lots of stories. I'm writing a book right now, and I'm really building the book around studies around people who have medical evidence for recovery from illnesses that are conceptualized very clearly and that we have tons of data about that we know that they are thought to be incurable. And so we've got, I'm talking about people like Dr. Patricia McCain, a physician who is diagnosed by biopsy with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. There's no cure for this. Your lungs turn to cardboard and you die. She went on disability. She couldn't get the oxygen working through her lungs at any point. At that point, finally, she was sleeping 18 to 20 hours a day. She couldn't work. Her life was fading. She then began to change her life at every level. She went to see Dr. Issam Naimi. He's a physician in Cleveland, Ohio. And he helped her begin changing her experience of herself and the world. A few years after that, she had a CT of the lungs, and her lungs were completely clean on CT scan. She now is so grateful, like many of these people, she was so grateful that she fundamentally changed her experience of herself and the world that now she works as a physician doing house visits, home visits for those who can't leave the house because they're so ill. And this is her way of making a return in gratitude for the illness and what it gave to her. It's a great story. She writes this email thing now called Doc's Daily Chuckle. Humor is a really important part of her life and in her recovery, and it's a fabulous, inspiring story. Claire Hazer, diagnosed also by a biopsy with pancreatic cancer in 2008 and told she was going to die. She decided if she was going to die, she was not going to spend the last few months of her life in dark hospital or in dark waiting rooms with other patients who were dying. She was going to spend those last months with those she loved, and she was going to celebrate her life. The hardest thing for her was accepting that she was going to die, but that became a pathway of liberation for her. And in 2015, she had a CT of the abdomen for unrelated reasons, and the cancer was gone, and her doctors didn't believe her. And it was a fascinating story. It's fascinating for me how important it was to her to have her doctors validate that she actually had it. So she made them, they convened a case conference, they reviewed her records, they decided she actually had pancreatic cancer, and they scratched their heads, and they finally were able to validate she actually had it for her. But they didn't want to believe it. It's a fascinating. Pablo, diagnosed with glioblastoma multiforme, told he was going to die. He did have radiation, and his story is also long and fascinating about the psychological changes he went through and the deep work he did to not live from a place of fear, but from a place of love and faith. And he decided, since cancer feeds on sugar, and that's a well-known fact, that he was going to starve the cancer to death. He went on a ketosis diet and did it under medical supervision. It was a very extreme diet. It's one that one should be done with a real understanding, and took lots of supplements and all that. And then he watched the cancer melt, and his MRI of the brain is now clean. And he was told after the radiation he would never be able to have a child again, or never be able to have a child. And he and his wife had their baby born this last July. And he is so deeply in love with his family and committed to, he's going to eat the ketosis diet, he said, going forward, because he wants to be alive for his wife and his child. And it's fascinating how a really strict diet for him was a pathway into an opportunity, whereas I think other people might experience that as a burden. I think one thing that's really important is when a person chooses their path after they receive a diagnosis is that whatever they do, it needs to be whatever they experience as liberating, and it has to come from a deeply authentic place within them, because one person would experience a ketosis diet as a burden and it wouldn't work. The next person would experience it as an opportunity and as a path to life. And for them, it's not a burden, it's an opportunity. And I think we need to understand the way people experience these things is fundamental and important. Personal decisions, and we need to understand how that works. I could tell you lots of stories. You know, Mary Bunnell with her metastatic melanoma. She started having these visions in the middle of the night that she felt this hand of God that just felt to her like it was coming home, and she felt so loved and so unconditionally loved after being raised in a loving but very conditionally loving and strict Mormon family. She was the one who didn't want to wear the same dresses as her sisters and be a good Mormon wife. She wanted to do her own thing. She wanted to be known for her mind and what she could do. And then she's pregnant by age 15, which kind of she interpreted at some level as proof that she maybe was a rebel at heart and not the good girl that her parents. And so she lived in, I think, a level of guilt and shame for a number of years, and then had a lot of difficulty figuring out why her 20s were so full of just feeling weak and tired all the time. And then when she was diagnosed with metastatic melanoma, she had these dreams where she felt so loved and cared for, and that she wasn't the defective individual that she thought she was, helped her experience herself really differently. And then during the period of those dreams, and she was being seen and treated by one of the leading melanoma researchers in the world, and they were measuring the melting of her tumor at a rate of a half inch a week. She now is healthy and vital and has a story to tell. And she was a computer scientist, a data geek, so she's not one of the, she didn't start off as one of these new agers. She was, I want the data sort of girl. And she has a great story, and I hope she writes a book about what she's doing. So lots of stories we can go into. The ones I chose for today are stories where I had good pictures available because I thought pictures are helpful for people. So I think today I'll tell you some stories. Some of them are spontaneous remission. Some of them are not from incurable illness, but they still have a really important point. And some of the stories are not spontaneous remission, but they're brilliant adaptations, which I think are also important. Because I think, like Kardec says, illnesses are sometimes a path of possible healing, and other times they're a test of the soul, and they have, so illnesses exist for different reasons, and the point is not always to recover. The point is to let it be what it is for the particular individual. The first story I'll tell is that of Emily Bowler. She is an artist, and this is a story about, in part, the power of nutritional density. She was she decided in 2008 that she didn't want to just be an artist on paper. She wanted to be an artist with her life and her body. She was in 2008 struggling with a lot. She had a son who had suicided in the context of his years of bipolar disorder and diabetes. And anyone who knows much about both of those illnesses know that bipolar on diabetes, and it's an awful combination. And the years of struggle with trying to save him from himself and the illnesses he had, and then his suicide at age 26 was devastating for her, especially in the context of her childhood abuse and just all of the burdens that she was carrying. So by the time 2008 arrived, she had pre-diabetes, she had heart disease, she had hypertension, high cholesterol, and massive amounts of anxiety and depression. She read a book that changed her life completely called Eat to Live by Joel Fuhrman, and she realized that all of her years of yo-yo dieting were an incomplete understanding, and realized that nutritional density is the story. It's not about food groups, it's not about dieting, it's not about calorie counting. It's about making sure that what you get in your body truly nourishes you and is loaded with the nutrition that you need. She began to realize that her body was craving food all the time because the hunger mechanism was triggered because she wasn't getting nutritional food a lot. And it's certainly true that in medical school you memorize all of these endless equations, and you start to see that at critical junction points there are minerals and vitamins that are there and reactions don't go through to completion. And you learn that in medical school, and then you quickly dismiss that because you're taught all these terrible habits and other beliefs about nutrition, and you forget that basic reality. And the picture on the right is her in July of 2009, 1 year later. On her blood sugar was completely normal. Her blood pressure numbers were normal. Her cholesterol was normal, and she no longer suffered from anxiety and depression. She had a healthy, vital life. And even though this is a story in part about nutritional density, I think it's really important to understand that all of that started not only after reading the book, but when she realized that she wanted to create art with her life and her body. She realized that she was the temple of God, that her body was a temple, and that she was going to begin thinking about and treating her body that way. And I think that's the deeper shift that occurred. It changed her perception of herself and then her experience of herself, and I think that's how this stuff works. So that shift in her own consciousness, helping her see herself more compassionately, is critical, and that's how these stories often work themselves out. So she has gone on and continued to deepen her understanding of these issues. I just wrote a blurb for her manuscript, and her book is going to come out February of 2019, and she's going to rock the world, I think. She's got quite a story, and her children are all grown now, so she's going to travel around and give workshops and continue writing books and doing this book, and I think she's going to do a great thing. I think she has a lot to teach people in eating disorders too. I spoke at a conference. Shocked at the preoccupation of food among all these researchers and therapists, and all the combination of healthy foods and foods that really don't understand nutrition. And so I think she's going to table that's going to help a lot of researchers and therapists think differently about these issues. June Stein is a story I love to tell. It's a story about the power of love and courage and faith. It's about two people who really love each other and went on a journey together. I'm going to tell the story of June, but I'll tell you briefly of the story of Lee, her husband. It's always fascinating to me, since you're taught that spontaneous remission is a fluke and has no scientific value, when you find three stories of spontaneous remission in one family with different, vastly different diagnoses, you start to think, well, maybe it's not just a fluke. If this is that repeatable, maybe there's something we need to understand. And that's what happened here. Lee was diagnosed years after his wife had gone down her path and journey. He was diagnosed with an intracranial aneurysm, and then he used a lot of the same techniques that his wife had used with her illness, and was very gratified and grateful when, after 2 months of meditating and change in nutrition, his aneurysm disappeared. And it was such a remarkable story. It was written up in a really good neurosurgery journal and has baffled his doctors quite a lot. But he did the same things his wife did. June really led the way on this. She was diagnosed in her early 20s, or I think it's mid-20s actually, with an illness called ankylosing spondylitis. Ankylosing spondylitis has no cure. It's a terrible illness. What happens is that your spine, your pelvis calcifies, and then the calcifications just creep up your vertebrae, freezing you into a frozen, immovable mass. And there's nothing you can do about it. You just get frozen in place. And June and Lee had been raised on the East Coast with very traditional understandings of allopathic medicine. They were living in San Francisco at the time, and she decided she was. And she started yoga, and yoga became a path of liberation for her. She used Rolfing and some energy work and nutritional changes and did a lot of other things, but all of that was focused on really helping her go more deeply into the yoga. And yoga was not just about the poses for her. It was a way of changing her experience of herself in the world. And even though I do suspect that the yoga probably helped crack the calcifications at some level, it wasn't just about that. And if we had more time, I could tell you stories about these major cathartic experiences that she would have around what it means to not just be a good girl or but to be free in relationships, to be free sexually and all these things, and how these things just liberated her life. She's now been disease-free for over 30 years and is a medical mystery for her doctors, but she doesn't look like she's frozen in place at all. So she's one of the most vital and happy and loving women I know. I tell the story of Dana Lewis because it's a different perspective on similar issues. She's part of a growing do-it-yourself movement. She was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes in a very brittle form of it at age 15, and lived for years very much having her quality of life impacted. She wasn't waking up sometimes at night to hear the alarm when her blood sugars would drop to dangerous levels. She was really struggling with all of this stuff and always just exhausted and just trying to stay alive. So she ended up creating her own artificial pancreas, made it open source so that others now around the world are using her open source software to deal with their own diabetes and adapt it to their own situations. And it's just an amazing story about this group who are not going to wait for the doctors to figure it out, and they're going to go out and find a solution for themselves. And I think it's a great movement. I spoke at a conference at a University of Texas just a few months ago with these do-it-yourselfers. And there's this one guy, he talked about how he had been disabled for years, just like his mother had been. And he found these obscure articles in the medical journals about the same diagnosis he had in rats and then in a dog, and the surgeries they had done with some research. And he eventually, just through sheer charm and manipulation and inspiring doctors to get interested, he finally convinced a doctor, and they figured out how to do a surgery and saved his life. And so he was able to invent the surgery that saved his life, and he now is a motivational speaker. And you know, he had all these journals and just working and working and working to figure this out, and he's done something, you know. And so these do-it-yourselfers, it's just an amazing story. I'll tell you the story a little bit of Stephen Hawking, since we all know who he was. He didn't have a spontaneous remission, but he was told at age 21, when he was diagnosed with ALS, that he would live no longer than 2 years, and that this was a death sentence for him. He died finally, I think it was this past February, at age another 55 years. And when he was asked about this, he said that he believes the reasons for his longevity were related to his sense of humor and his interest in keeping his mind active. Now, we all know he kept his mind very active, and he had quite a sense of humor. My literary agent was working on a book with him back in the last few years, and said that he will never forget the vitality that radiated out of those blue eyes of his and the sense of humor that Stephen Hawking had. And so this is an amazing thing. So even though Stephen Hawking was confined in his body at one level, at another level, he was not confined at all. And just to give you an example of his sense of humor, he was on an HBO show with John Oliver at one point. And John Oliver, they were talking about parallel universes. And John Oliver said, is there a parallel universe where I'm smarter than you? And Stephen Hawking said, yes, and also one where you're funny. And then John Oliver says, is there a parallel universe where my alter ego is dating actress Charlize Theron? And Stephen Hawking said, no, that's beyond the bounds of scientific possibility. So Stephen Hawking, he was an adventurous soul. I'm on the faculty at Singularity University, and Singularity University was founded in part by a guy named Peter Diamandis. They both are adventurous souls. And Peter Diamandis' whole PR stunt in terms of funding his work to get into space, if he could get Stephen Hawking to go into zero gravity flight with him. And so they applied to do that. The FAA said no. And doctors said no. And so they ended up buying massive malpractice insurance policies for all kinds of people, and ended up finally getting permission, and then Stephen Hawking, against everything his doctors was telling him, he went into zero G, and so they just kept doing these loops, and he went way beyond what they thought was medically possible. Going to be confined by his perceived bodily limitations. So I'm going to tell the story briefly of Amy Mullins as well. She didn't have spontaneous remission, but she was born as a double amputee, and she decided that what others perceive as a disability, she was going to see as an opportunity, and she has started a cultural conversation that is completely different and new for us, where she refused to be seen as somebody who's disabled. She set records. She was the first disabled person to compete in normal NCAA sports. She has set records, and then she has gone on and worked as an actress, as a model. She has, I think, 12 pairs of prosthetic limbs, 12 pairs of boots that she wears for different occasions, and she decided that prosthetic limbs should not be just functional. They should be objects of art and beauty, and she has gone on and done, I think she won on Dancing with the Stars and things, and so she has done a lot. She has started a conversation about the way. I love this quote by her. It is no longer a conversation about overcoming deficiency. It's a conversation about potential. A prosthetic limb doesn't represent the need to replace loss anymore. So people that society once considered disabled can now become the architects of their own identities and indeed continue to change those identities by designing their bodies from a place of empowerment. It is our humanity and all the potential within it that makes us beautiful. I think that's a great story, and it showcases just how important it is that we don't see what looks like a limitation. It doesn't have to be a limitation. It can be the doorway into a different life. And she is considered one of the most empowered and empowering women on the planet, and I think that it's a really important conversation that she's trying to start. Rachel Donalds has a story that really fits in a number of categories, including in the do-it-yourself movement. She was at the Harvard School of Public Health and struggling with Hashimoto's thyroiditis, being told that she would need to take medications for the rest of her life. She was suffering from the impact of 3 concussions, having a lot of difficulty concentrating, and decided that she was going to create an app that would help her recognize when she's in chronic fight or flight, which inhibits healing, and to see if she could find a way to get herself into a more parasympathetic state, which is a place of more healing and wholeness and relaxation and connection with oneself and others, and created the app that did that. And then since she was at the School of Public Health, began to realize there might be implications elsewhere for this, for others, and has been medical advisor and the angel investor for it, and we'll see how this goes, but it's a beautiful app, and hopefully if this is a way that technology can help people detect not what physiology you think you're in or what you want to be in or what you think you should be in, but what your actual physiological state is, and then help you find ways out of that, that's a pretty cool thing. And I think that's the promise of this new medicine that we're in, just in the early stages of, is where we can start using technology to help us become the CEOs of our own health. That's a fabulous thing, and it's really leaving behind the assumptions of 18th century biology and physics, which has characterized medicine up to this point, and stepping into the world of modern physics, which has been around for 70 years, but it's the implications are so vast that even physicists don't know what to do with it. It's such a different way of thinking about consciousness and the connection between mind and body. And what's great is, even though we can't get our own minds around it yet, technology is going to help us take this to the next stage by giving us more and more stuff in our smartphones, where we will have more and more data. I think it was Peter Diamandis said, that in 5 years, you will get better health care in a remote village of India than you will in the United States, because the experts at Harvard and Stanford are still alive. And I that tongue-in-cheek, of course, but I think change is coming more rapidly than we realize. I think technology, if we do this thoughtfully is going to help us move in a direction where we don't really have a paradigm that knows how to do that yet. So instead of creating an emoji, you create a bioji, because it reads your body, reads what's actually going on physiologically before your cortical inhibitions shut it down and try to tell you what you should be feeling or experiencing, or what you think you're experiencing. So here, if we had more time, I would go into more of the research studies. But the next step, you know, I think it was a really important step several hundred years ago when the early scientists took disease away from the church and said, your illness is a judgment from God or the reflection of something wrong. I think that was an important step. It allowed these early scientists to begin creating a taxonomy of disease. It allowed them to begin creating a classification system where they could distinguish the signs and symptoms of one illness from the signs and symptoms of another illness and create this naming the rational language of science, which is a fabulous thing, because it was a universal language. It wasn't the language of Catholics as opposed to the language of Buddhists or the Protestants, so these different religions. It was the universal language of science. That was a brilliant. It was a science of disease and not a science of health. And so what we have had since then is really a science of disease, and we don't even study health and vitality. And that's starting to change in our time rather rapidly now, but we haven't really moved firmly into that era yet. It's still largely in daily practice, and in our clinics and our hospitals, it's still dominated by a science of disease, and that needs to change. Doctors are trained to recognize disease and to prescribe medications, and we really treat symptoms and not causes of things by and large, whether it's a heart attack or depression. We don't really go into the causes. So it's important, I think, to understand that, like we were saying a few minutes ago, in the West, we are brilliant at focusing on the parts and breaking down components into their smaller components, whether it's through a telescope and a lab or with a microscope or with a telescope in physics and all that. And we, in doing that, we divide all these different parts from each other, but we don't see the big picture. We send a medical problem to the physician. We send a psychological problem to the therapist. We send a spiritual problem to the priest, rabbi, or minister, or imam. But we don't understand that it's a person behind these masks, and that the vitality and the possibilities come from understanding that interaction and realizing that the source of the problem may not be in the discipline that you're taught to. Spirituality is not one piece of the pie that makes up the mind, body, and spirit of the human person. I think Kardec and Xavier understand that really well. After years spent in seminary and medical school, I'm telling you, even the theologians really separate all of this stuff out. And I think the truth is, spirit is more like the rind and pulp of an orange rather than the piece of a pie. I think it creates, infuses, and directs all aspect of mind and body. And I think that the readings that have been talked about a lot this weekend and the lectures that have been given really show that brilliantly, I believe. Probably having an orange on screen is a good thing in the state of California, where you see it on all the license plates too, I noticed. So, really interested in the democratization of medicine. I have on my wall in my office at McLean, I have the independence, the Emancipation Proclamation and the Declaration of Independence. And people ask, there's this young lady that asked me recently, why do you have these on your wall? You're a psychiatrist. I said, well, it's a good thing that the psychiatrists were not at the Boston Tea Party, because what they probably needed was not Prozac. They needed to throw off the chains of oppression. Medicine and psychiatry and psychology, they should be means of liberation and are used to more as tools of conformity. And I think what people often need, I think what we all often need, is something that liberates a deeper aspect of us. So we need more democracy and human rights more self-help movements and strength-based approaches to doctors as coaches rather than just experts on our lives and bodies. We need less passivity, less learned helplessness, less laying in the bed waiting for the doctor to come. We need to, I think a doorway for us is that our smartphones can become like the tricorders on Star Trek, where we begin to more and more available to us, and you can see what your lifestyle changes be that our apps and that sort of thing are going to give us data, and we'll be able to see the direct impact of our choices on our lives and our health, and that will allow us to begin taking charge of our health. And as Peter Diamandis says, become the CEO of your own health. So I think we need to treasure our exceptions. When there are none, work gets so dull that no one cares to carry it further. Keep them always uncovered and in sight. Exceptions are like the rough brickwork of a growing building, which tells that there is more to come and shows where the next construction is to be. So just like we study ultimate achievement in sports and in business and elsewhere, we need to start studying these cases in medicine. Right now, we do these studies, but we group everything around the mean. And so we know what the average person does in our studies, but we screen out the exceptional achievers. And those are the ones we need to be studying, because it's good to know what the average person does. That's important. But I'd like to know, there's a lot of smart people that you see get diagnosed with these illnesses, and they're very motivated people, but they're just told that this is what your prognosis is, and to just believe what the doctor says. And I think we need to create the possibility. So, it's a mistake to dismiss cases simply as flukes and anecdotes. They are priceless treasures, I believe. And I think we need to start wrapping up. So I'm going to conclude. I'm not going to go through some of the studies that have been done, but what I will do is play for you a brief video that was sent to me by a person who has his own remarkable story. He is a long survivor of an illness that is not thought to be typically achievable. And he sent me this after I was on the Oprah show and had, he's just a beautiful artist. And I thought he called this the magnificent of you, the magnificence of you. And so I thought I would just play this as a way of wrapping up, and then we can go on from there. So thank you.
Take it in. Oh, this has gotta be a good life. This has gotta be a good life. This could really be a good life. I say, thinking now, 'cause hopelessly they're hopeless. We have so much to feel good about. Oh, this has gotta be a good life. This has gotta be a good life. This could really be a good life. Good life. I say, oh, this is really what you came for. The city is a fine night. This could really be a good life. Good, good life. Oh, yeah. Good, good life. There's to complain about.